Indigenous communities in Canada really have more knowledge about their territories than the government does. And they've become very powerful, I think, using these mapping technologies in advocating for the recognition of their rights and for exercising territorial governance and informing decision-making in the territories. These mapping projects have also been really important for celebrating and resurging Indigenous languages and cultures, and the very important task of public education in a world where I think a lot of the non-Aboriginal neighbors of Indigenous communities know little or nothing about the lands that they live on. And these mapping projects have been very important for that. And so our talk today is actually not going to detail through the different tactics and strategies that we've used in the kind of mapping projects that we've been doing, but rather the way the kinds of mapping efforts have been impactful in the exercise of Indigenous territorial governments and in informing decision-making within an Indigenous landscape. In the case that we'll be describing, that land rights have never been ceded, but nor have they been recognized on the ground by the government. And so it's this very challenging environment in which to have these principles of Indigenous ways of life recognized. So we're going to be speaking here about the territories of the Coast Salish peoples in southwest British Columbia and northwest Washington, but mostly we've been working in the Canadian context. And Kathleen and I have been working for many years together for the Hul’qumi’num Treaty Group, which is an Aboriginal organization that represents six First Nations in and around the southeast corner of Vancouver Island and in the Gulf Islands and on the lower Fraser River. It's an area that obviously, as you can see from the Google Earth imagery here, is close to many major cities like Vancouver and Victoria, Nanaimo. It has been carved out a reserve landscape of Indian reserves back in the 1860s and 70s. And probably the most important feature of this landscape is the fact that in 1884, there was a land grab by a private individual, a coal baron named James Dunsmuir, who arranged to have the entire east coast of Vancouver Island granted to him in fee simple, so as private freehold title, in exchange for helping to build a railway from Victoria up the east coast of the island to access the coal fields. All of this land then fell into private hands, including all of the territories of the Hul’qumi’num communities and their neighboring communities. And the recognition of their territorial rights and their ownership of the land and has still an unresolved issue today. There's been no treaty agreements. There have been active negotiations of the kind we heard about this morning from Hélène, but unfortunately, unlike her case, there's been no ability to reach an agreement in principle or a final agreement. There's deep disagreement about how these rights ought to be exercised on private land. So today, if we were to look at a map of this territory, you can see in purple here are the lands owned in fee simple by private logging interests. Three large logging companies that make decisions about their forestry, just like a small private landowner would make the decision about the garden in their backyard. The Forest Act doesn't apply. The logging is large-scale industrial clear cutting. All the orange areas are private lands owned by small landowners for residential housing and agriculture. There are a few parks in the landscape. And a few lands that have reverted back to the crown over the years in terms of taxes that weren't paid during the Depression and so on. So it's an extremely challenging landscape that the Hul’qumi’num people are trying to exercise their territorial governance in to have their land rights recognized. Kathleen is going to talk about some of the challenges that in exercising this the Hul’qumi’num people's decision making about the land, their vision of the future of the land and how it should be used, how it should be respected, And it, these vary widely from areas around forestry, urban development, docks and foreshore leases, shipping and dumping. And I think the stories that she's going to bring here will help illuminate the challenges and some of the successes the Hul’qumi’num have had in moving this forward. So, Kathleen.
So thank you very much. My name is Kathleen Johnnie. I am a Coast Salish woman. I am from the Penelika tribe, and on my father's side and on my mother's side, she is Lyackson, and she is an elected member of the Lyackson Council. First, I wanted to give you a bit of an overview of the Lyackson First Nation. We have approximately 210 members. We are a Coast Salish nation, as Brian has mentioned. We have a membership of approximately, I've already talked about that, and we are governed by a hereditary chief and an elected council. Second, I wanted to explain my role at the Lyackson First Nation. I am their lands and resources coordinator. It's my job to look at all of their lands, all of their resources, and identify what is appropriate and what is not appropriate for lands and resources extraction or use or occupancy. I have a lot more in my speaking notes, but that's all I'm going to say about me. Third, I wanted to acknowledge our relationship and partnership with the University of Victoria and Brian Thom in particular. Brian has been instrumental in a lot of the work that we have been doing in the management and protection of our lands and in our study and research on our lands. He is an anthropologist, but he is also a bit of a land use planning and mapping nerd. And we really enjoy, I'm saying that just to see if you're paying attention, because we have the unenviable position of being up right after the afternoon coffee break after a long day of people talking. So thank you for listening. What I would like to share with you is what we call the good, the bad, and the ugly. And I'll start with the ugly. Grace Islet is a small nation or a small island in Fulford Harbor, which is nestled in Fulford Harbor and Salt Spring Island. And this island is privately owned. It seems to be everybody's dream to own their own island. And so they purchased this island with the intention of building a house. And this island for the First Nation is an extremely important sacred site. It is a burial island for us, and our burials were above ground. We used burial cairns to protect our people. And they incorporated in the foundation of the house our burial cairns. And that was an extreme offense against our people and our culture and our laws. So we took the opportunity to rise up against this situation, and we fought and fought for years, actually many, many years. There were about 10 or 12 nations working together collaboratively to fight this initiative. And eventually this $900,000 island had to be purchased back from the province of BC for $5.7 million to ensure the protection of these burial sites. Unfortunately, the foundations had been in place, and we are now undertaking the long work of taking away that or deconstructing that foundation. So I wanted to share that. It was a costly program for both the First Nations from our cultural perspective, but also to the province of BC and the taxpayers of BC. The next project I'm calling the bad, which is Kinder Morgan. Kinder Morgan is a pipeline that is being proposed to bring diluted bitumen from the Alberta tar sands to the coast of BC. Then it will be shipped by marine tanker traffic through the Salish Seas, which will pass our island, Valdez Island. And it has the extreme potential of having a serious accident. The issue that we have with this is that marine tanker traffic in and of itself, actually our island is made of sandstone, so we can actually hear the low frequency sound that the screws on the large ships create in the island itself. So that is one of the big issues. If a spill were to occur, and they assure us that would only occur within 300 years, one catastrophic spill in every 300 years or so, then it could deeply affect our fisheries, our shorelines, our access to our sacred sites. So we're very concerned about this, and we have intervened in the what is called the National Energy Board hearing review to express our concerns, and our chief, a hereditary chief, Pahalakton, has provided to the National Energy Board the information that his role as a traditional chief and his name will exist in 300 years when that catastrophic spill has occurred, and he, whoever carries that name, will have the responsibility that he has taken up today. And so whoever is there will have the same responsibilities that he has now. And then the final thing that I wanted to talk about, which was really the land use planning is and the mapping, is that we have undertaken land use planning with Brian's help and many others' help to ensure that we are expressing what our interests are on the land and in the water, to make sure that our community's concerns are going to be heard by the Crown in a very substantive way. We have shown that we can win. We have shown that we have hopes to win. And now in the land use plan, this is the good part. We are showing how we intend to map out what is important to us, and not just map out, but use policy to overlay mapping, because mapping cannot show all of our interests. We cannot do site-specific or resolve site-specific issues with mapping, but we can resolve site-specific issues with policies that protect archaeological sites, that protect the landscape, that protect the viewscapes, that protect our really important cultural landscapes and waterways that we consider to be of primary importance to the First Nation. So I'm told to conclude. S'il vous plaît. So I wanted to show that to you in this way because mapping itself and of itself will not show the depth of the interest. It looks like we only use the outer portions of Valdez Island, but that is not the full extent of our use of this island. We have so many intangible ways of using this space that it is really hard to describe on these tiny little 8.5 by 11 maps, or even if we created these larger maps. But we recognize also the usefulness of having this mapped out, having these layers available to us, to our staff, because if we don't have this, then Grace Islet will happen again. Then Kinder Morgan will get to do whatever they want with that, with impunity. And so today we are taking up our governing authorities and choosing how we will govern our lands and our waters for our own protection and use.
Thank you.
Okay, great. Thank you so much for that. Our next speaker is Sébastien Caquard, who's in the Geography Department at Concordia University, and the title of his talk has changed a little. The new title is Places, Bracket Online, Maps and Stories, Mapping Life Stories of Refugees.
All right, thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation, for being here. I'm a bit of an outsider here. I didn't come with my community member because I don't work with communities. I'm a cartographer, and I'm interested in the mapping of stories. I've been working on different community mapping projects. I'm actually part of a research project on mapping residential schools in Canada. So it's a project led at Carleton University by Fraser Taylor, and it's part of a reconciliation process where we're trying to identify where residential schools were, so the presence of those schools and the physical location to put on the map, but then to fill them with stories, with memories related to those places, so trying to link those elements together. I'm also supervising a couple of students working on indigenous mapping issues. One of them is Thom McGurk. His work is on assessing how online mapping projects developed in collaboration with indigenous communities are really part of an empowerment process, or is it just a new form of technological colonization. So he's assessing a selection of 17 websites across Canada that deal with mapping projects involving communities, and he uses decolonizing framework to analyze them. Unfortunately, he cannot be here because he's been on jury duty for a year and a half now, so his project is moving very, very slowly, but he would have been a good person to have here. I'm also involved in an emerging project try to bring people working on community mapping, and we'll have a week organizing a summit in 2 weeks from now at Concordia in collaboration with UVic. And we'll have a guest speaker on Thursday, November 5th. It's John Corbett from UBC Okanagan, talking about the power of community mapping. So if you are in Montreal on Thursday, November 5th, and you're interested in community mapping, just get in touch with me and I'll give you some details. What I'm going to talk about today is the mapping of life stories from refugees. So it's not exactly things that we've been talking about so far, but that may be of interest to some of you. Basically, what I'm interested in is the interface of the map between places and stories in both ways. How can we look at stories through places using map to enter stories? And historians are interested in that because they're interested in looking at their history from a different perspective, from a spatial perspective. Ethnographer as well, literary study as well. We call that the spatial turn like a few years ago. So one of those many turns. But there is this idea that we can learn about a story by entering through places. And by having map, we can help people to learn about those stories. And I'm interested in the way around. We can learn about places through stories, obviously. And this is the idea of deep mapping. The only way you can learn about a place is to know the stories about that place. But the problem is, like, how do we map those stories? They're not necessarily tangible. There's a lot of emotion associated to that, and we don't necessarily know how to map them. So the project I'm going to present today is a project that tried to reconciliate the power of the map as a way to synthesize information and the emotional dimension associated to place through stories and see how can they both work together. So I had a bit of a video to start, but it's going to be an image. This is a story from Oscar Gazana, who is a refugee from Rwanda. He was born in 1951 in Kibuye in Rwanda, and his dad passed away when he was five, and he was raised by his older brother, who became in charge of his education. But at nine, he had to leave Rwanda for ethnic tension, and then he's been traveling around Africa and different other places. And here in this section of his story, so it's a 5-hour live story recorded by the Center for Oral History in Montreal. It talks about him coming back to Gizani, to Kigali and Gizani after the genocide. And then he described how he feels about the city of Gizani. And he says the city changes its color. Even when there is sun, you don't see the sun. When I went to Gizani, it was not Gizani. It was a place, macabre, that did not have any characteristic physics or symbolic of what I had known before. So there's a kind of a deep and emotional description of a place that did not exist anymore and that can be barely represented by any cartographic representation, any cartographic symbol. So the idea of the project is to look at how we can combine empiricist representation, like conventional maps, with some more artistic and personal in order to bring the more emotional dimension associated to place. So in order to do that, we have selected 10 stories from the Montreal Life Stories Project. So it's a project that have been collected 500 stories from refugees by the Center for Oral History. So I work with historians on this project. It's funded by the FQRSC. We try to see how we can combine those different elements. So the first step is to move from a video to something that is mappable, some kind of a data. So to turn a story that is very personal, that is very emotional, into transcription. It's a first way of translating and then transcript into a database. So we've done that through this this reading grid. So we have what we call spatial-temporal events. So we divide its story into moments that are associated to some specific event and some specific meaning associated to this event and the place. And then we record a couple of things. Who are the characters involved in this moment in the story? What is the scale of the place? Is it a positive, negative association? Is it an imposed movement to this place? Is it a forced movement? Is there any violence associated? So you can see like the moment that I just described from Oscar, where the analyst commented, it's a very emotional description of the city and people after the genocide. So we have some comments. So the step then is to turn this into an online map, and that's the first process, how we can turn this story into a map. And then after that, the next step, and we're not quite there yet, but we're working on that, is to contact the storyteller and to ask them to comment and to develop their own map with no technology, with whatever they feel about their emotional relationship to the place they've been encountered throughout their life. And then the last stage of this project will be to see how we can combine those different perspectives, the more conventional and empiristic, a bit more quantitative representation with a more personal, and see if those kinds of representation can talk to each other instead of opposing them. So I've worked with a computer developer to develop this application. So basically it takes the data. It goes through Nunalit, which is an open source software that has been developed at Carlton that we reframed for our purpose, use some open source libraries, and then the data is in a Google spreadsheet. Anyone can use it, anyone can represent its own or her own story, and then it turn it into an online map that represents places and elements associated to places as well as movement between places, because here we're talking about a life story. So I'm going to try to... Just to see if you follow me as well, I'm going to try to... get a little quick demonstration, because I know... So basically, we are here. Oh, right, here I am. So this is the map. Okay, no, this is not what I wanted to do, but it's gonna work anyway. So. So what we see here is a video of the application. So those are the different elements in the story, where the story is moving, where Oscar, what is he talking about? So he's talking in blue, it's like more family events associated to places. And then it's a bit chaotic because there's a lot of places that are mentioned throughout this story. So we can see what kind of elements are associated to each places. And the further you're outside of the circle, the later it is in the story. So it's a 5 hour story. And then some places in black are more associated with genocide. Some places in blue are more associated with family memories. Some places in pink are more associated with politics and the politics of refugees. And you can see where it's been moving. It's been going in Uganda, in Congo, Democratic Republic of Congo. It lived in Libya as well. And then you can combine those different elements in order to see and the link where places, where it's been, places that have been mentioned. And you can see the richness, especially of the experience, of the story, of the events that have been going through his entire life. And the end of the story is in Ottawa, where he went back to school and he get a PhD. So there are different ways of looking at stories. You can look at the structure of the story from where it started to where it ended on top. But you can also look at the places that have been mentioned throughout the story, places of importance, and you can see a slightly different pattern. Also, it's very similar. And you can try to recreate the chronology of the life. At the beginning, this is what we wanted to do, but the historians we were working with were way more interested by the structure of the narrative, how the story unfolded during the interview. And so the idea now is to combine not only one, but five stories from Rwanda and five stories from Haiti, and see if there are some commonalities in places, places of importance, places of memories that bring similar memories associated to those places. Then the next place, next step will be to involve the storyteller and ask them to comment and to develop their own personal representation. And then we'll try to see how we can merge this more technologically and remoted representation from the content and the emotional dimension to the more personal representation that this storyteller may have, this refugee may have about their experience. And then the next step, if we go as far, will be to improve the connection between the representation and the original story. Because here we disconnected the movie, the interview, the content from what's on the map. And it's always the problem. When you have a map, you erase everything you had before to make something simple that shows you something else. But it's important to keep the original representation. So what we're trying to do is to, by navigating through the story, being able to come back, by navigating to the map, to come back to any places of the story. So for instance, if I have a place where three people are talking about this place, I could click on it and have the videos where they talk about that place and how they talk about it and what kind of personal perception is associated to that place. Just to finish, I want to thank you, Jean-Pierre Fizet, for the development, and Stephanie Dimitrovas, who collected a lot of data for this project. Thank you.
Thanks. Well, if some of the frustrations that Kathleen expressed about the limitations of the map format that couldn't show some of the extra dimensions, I think we've seen a great example of how to build both, I guess, time and the experience of traveling through landscapes and some of the emotional connotations as well. So our next and final paper is by Stephen Schnoor. It'll be co-presented, I guess. And he's from McGill University, and the title is Community Video and Resistance to Mining in Guatemala and Panama.
Thank you. That's actually the subtitle, so I'm titling it Bearing Witness and Opening Sightlines. And just sort of a preliminary caveat, I'll be discussing some very complicated political situations, very complicated conflicts, and I'll be doing great injustice to all of them by glossing over the details entirely, just in the interest of time. And I'd like to leave as much time as possible for Rosa to speak. But of course, if there's questions, I'm happy to field them in regards to situations. So I'm working as a postdoc with Instead in CICADA, and several months ago I was in the region of Panama and Guatemala teaching video to some of our partner organizations, Rosa's community being one of them, a community in Guatemala as well being another. And the work entails providing equipment and teaching how to use it, video cameras, computers for editing. And to give a bit of a sense of the context and the vision that guides this work, I'm going to back up 17 years, almost to the day, actually. It was late October 1998 in Honduras when Hurricane Mitch completely devastated the country. I mean, 70% of the country's transportation infrastructure was almost completely destroyed. 70% of the crops were destroyed. 3/4 of the population had no water. And it's in the throes of this devastation that, in an example of what Naomi Klein calls disaster capitalism, the Honduran Congress very quietly ratified a new mining law. And it's a mining law that reflects a lot of the economic structural adjustment reforms that are often imposed by the World Bank and the IMF. And that entails eliminating limitations on direct foreign investment, allowing for open pit mining, which had previously been illegal, allowing for unlimited access to water, which is very important in open pit mining. It uses hundreds of thousands of liters per water for the cyanide leaching, very low royalty rates, 1% in Honduras, taxation holidays, legalizing forced expropriation. And the first company to avail itself of the new mining law was Canada's Glamis Gold, since purchased by Goldcorp, and they built an open-pit gold mine called San Martin in 1999. Within a year or two, stories were emerging of some serious, serious problems in the valley. Rivers drying up, illnesses that had never before been seen in people and in cattle, rates of miscarriages were skyrocketing, and the Goldcorp was consistently saying that they were a responsible company, there's no credibility to these claims, as was the Canadian government saying that these are lies made up by activists who are seeking to be cause trouble. In any event, I traveled to the region with a video camera to document, and this is, you see the cyanide leaching here in a leach pad, and I found, this is the tailings pond, there was much credibility to all of the claims and more. Indeed, as the environmental committee was saying, it looked as though 19 of 21 rivers had completely dried up. People had strange rashes, their hair was falling out, miscarriages in people and in cattle. And so I produced a documentary, an hour long, of community testimonials called, in English, All the Glitters is in Gold. And it was used by the community in Honduras and beyond to warn people about the effects of this new type of mining. And I should say the mining law reform that Honduras experienced in 98 was subsequently mimicked throughout Central America and beyond. They were using this video, as far as I know, in El Salvador, because I was in El Salvador doing a video workshop in 2009, and I saw a big stack of this particular DVD. And then I returned to the region for screenings. We went to the towns surrounding the mine and to broadcast the film. And this, for me, was the first time that I saw the capacity of community engagement with video. And for me, it was a powerful moment to be able to see reactions of people who had already heard these stories, but for them to sort of encounter them in one condensed unit, especially this man here, Rodolfo Artiega, who had been steadfast in his opposition to the mine for years. Upon seeing this video, he teared up, he was crying, and I was sort of a bit confused at first because he knew these stories. I mean, they're very sad stories. But I think what had happened is somehow he sensed that there was legitimacy of his stance that was provided by virtue of this story being told via the medium of a documentary, that somehow he was being received in a different way. And it was in that sense that I thought it would be important to provide these tools to people in these communities. One quick example of the use of video in a mining-related struggle to bear witness to a crime that's being committed is in the El Estor region of Guatemala. Some of you may know this story. I'm going to tear through the details of this one as well. But in early 2007, there was a forced eviction of five indigenous Mayan Quechí communities illegally by a Canadian mining company called Sky Resources. But 1,000 cops and soldiers came in. It was violent. It was a two-day eviction of five Mayan indigenous Quechí communities. In this one, they dismantled the people's homes. In another community, they came in with AK-47s and burned their homes down. There's the army. And the mining company, these are the workers who are trying to mask their faces so they're not identified. The mining company claimed that everything was peaceful, everything was legal, everything was legitimate. In fact, the day after the forced evictions, they released a press release saying that everything has been peaceful, and they even went so far as to thank the police, as you can see in the highlighting, for maintaining a peaceful atmosphere during this action. So the use of video, in particular the internet, was very useful in this sense. So I was able to post a short clip, 10 minutes, that contradicted, that challenged the mining company's claim, and that video was then subsequently used to sort of galvanize international support for the resistance that was already happening on the ground. We can speak more of this later. I also went back to the region to screen it in the same sense, and it was very humbling to see people's reactions to their own forced eviction. They, by the way, had re-inhabited the land, and this is back in the same areas that had been evicted. They're climbing into the rafters to see the film. It's then that I sort of thought that it's important to endow communities with this technology. So this is in Honduras with the indigenous campesino organization teaching them video. And I subsequently, as I was saying, was then in Guatemala and Panama. This is from a few months ago in Guatemala. And unfortunately, is Aniceto here? Did he arrive? He is here. Okay. He was here. Okay, so Aniceto had a travel delay, and he was delayed. In any event, I was working with his organization for Demi. Perhaps he can speak a bit in the Q&A. So in San Miguel Estuacán in Guatemala, they have the same type of mine as the San Martin mine. It's now just subterranean. It had been open pit and subterranean. And there's been a lot of resistance through FREDEMI against the mine. A lot of the problems seen in the Siria Valley of Honduras have been seen in Guatemala. And so we've donated to them a camera. We've donated a computer. We've taught them editing. And these are my three students who are working on an editing project. Their first video, and they produced a very nice video actually about the exorbitant prices of electricity that they're facing. And just to wrap up very quickly before I give the floor to Rosa, this is in Urracá, and this is where Rosa and Saturnino are from. And this is doing a participatory video in Panama, in Urracá region, and I'll let Rosa speak to the particulars of it. We didn't, in this case, have a computer, but that'll be in phase two of the project, but we did give them a camera and taught them how to shoot. And the intention then is to follow up with editing training. There are immense challenges being faced in, well, indigenous people throughout Panama, and certainly in the Urracá district, which is right beside the Comarca Nobebugle, which is where Celestino comes from. This is them working on shooting a video. They shot a very nice video of life, thank you, of life in a village that has a river with no bridge. And in the rainy season, the river is violent and people drown annually crossing the river. And so it's a video they made about this situation in their lives. And I should say it was also nice to screen it. So this is, they got out the generator and every night we were screening. We had a portable projector. So we were screening videos, not just about the stuff they were shooting and not just news footage, but I just returned from another mine, Canadian Panamanian mine in Panama, the Petaquia mine that operated from 2007 to 2013. Now is abandoned, completely abandoned, an open pit cyanide leaching mine abandoned, and it has never been remediated. And so I won't show you the video, but I'll show you some stills, and it was fascinating for them to see what the state of this mine is. So literally it has been completely abandoned. There are big barrels of cyanide one can walk up to and touch. I'll show you some of these images. This man here who I was doing the shooting with, told me that this color of water is the same color that was the river that crosses through the town. And I was also hearing from townspeople that the water, there are actually three documented episodes of total fish kills in the local river from this mine during its short lifespan. He said, this is what the river smelled like and looked like. And villagers were telling me that while the mine was in operation, walking through the river, of course, no bridge, would cause your legs to burn. The skin would burn as it came into contact with the water. And this is the abandoned mine here. Of course, here's your cyanide. This is the tailings pond. And so showing this in Urracá was of interest to see what a tailings pond that is overflowing looks like. And you can actually see severe erosion on the tailings pond and a pipe that is flooding water straight from the tailings pond, the toxic tailings, right into the two rivers, the Molejon and the Turbe River. And so these were the types of things we were doing with video in Urracá by night. After our workshops, we're having discussions, showing news clips about protests in Panama, showing footage of this nature, just so they know what they're confronting. We're not going to go there. And just before I turn it to Rosa, who we'll talk about, who's actually one of my students, I'll just say that during one of the meetings in Urracá, it was several people who had mentioned, as they said, you don't just get into a fight. You assess your situation first, or you will get knocked out. You must plan, you must prepare, you must educate. And in that sense, I saw a huge possible uptake for video technology to be part of that campaign of galvanizing community and education. So I'll turn the podium to Rosa. Perhaps we can give her just a minute more than what is allotted. Rosa, si quiere hablar algunas palabras, Rosa.
Muy buenas tardes. Agradezco al profesor Daviken, acá al estudiante Esteban y a otros estudiantes que nos visitaron a Panamá. Mi nombre es Rosa Santander, vengo del futuro distrito de Urracá. Nuestra historia de lucha ha empezado hace mucho tiempo. Desde el año 82 hacia acá, ya la población tuvieron más organizado, por el cual la comarca Nobebugle de Panamá, en la cual nosotros formaba parte del equipo, cuando en 1997 el gobierno nos recoge la inspiración del pueblo, de los pueblos originarios, y impone algunos artículos diferentes que ellos quisieron, y crearon la ley 10 en la comarca Nobebugle, y nosotros formábamos parte, nos dejaron fuera de un límite, dejaron fuera la parte donde nosotros estamos ahorita, que es el distrito de Urracá. Desde ahí hacia acá hemos tenido experiencia muy mala a nivel del gobierno por el pueblo indígena. Siempre la discriminación, siempre el desarrollo de la minería, diferentes clases de proyectos que ellos llevan, pero en contra de nuestra posición como pueblo originario. Desde ahí hacia acá nosotros seguimos organizando, mantenemos nuestra estructura del 2004, formamos entonces grupo de coordinaciones como coordinadora de mujeres, entonces presido el lugar en este momento del distrito de Urracá. Por eso entonces, gracias a, al cacique celetino Mariano Gallardo de Nidrini, que forma parte de la comarca de la Ley 10 y nos ha dado la oportunidad de llegar en contacto y conocer al profesor Daviken y a sus estudiantes que nos enviaron a Panamá. Esteban fue a dar la capacitación a nosotros en las comunidades para hacer mapeos comunitarios. El profesor Mateo, el estudiante, fue también a hacer el trabajo para enseñar a hacer mapeo comunitario. Esteban fue a capacitarnos en la cámara cómo grabar video, cómo crear un video para llevar diferentes informaciones a nivel del mundo, del país, ya que donde nosotros estamos, nosotros no tenemos ningún recurso. Desde hace mucho tiempo estamos organizando, mantenemos nuestro congreso a nivel del distrito de Urracá, pero no teníamos una cadena hacia afuera, pues, con nadie que nos apoyara. Pues ahora tenemos este contacto y gracias al Colin Scott, que nos ha apoyado, como lo dijo Esteban, estamos muy agradecidos porque por primera vez en nuestra región es muy distante. Tenemos que caminar 4 o 5 días de un lugar a otro caminando porque no tenemos más manera de hacerlo. En nuestra región es grande y no tenemos acceso a equipos como eso. Pues hemos dado la gracia al profesor, el apoyo que nos ha brindado. Hoy día pues hay 4 o 5 jóvenes que ya se han preparado en el manejo de la cámara. Ahora podemos hablar sobre de mapeo comunitario. Tenemos un estudiante llamado Mario Rodríguez en Panamá que se está preparando en geografía e historia y está muy interesado también. Esto tengo fe de que va a venir también acá a prepararse para así entonces tener más contacto con todo el grupo que está apoyando las poblaciones indígenas. Y en esa forma también nosotros con la cámara podemos llevar diferentes videos de esta reunión, las palabras que nos orgullecen, las palabras que nos enriquecen cada día mejor, que nos preparan mejor en nuestro trabajo como pueblos indígenas, porque anteriormente el gobierno ha hecho todo lo que ha querido. Donde yo vivo, en el corregimiento de Calobébora, es un lugar muy apartado, pero en 1940 hubo una explotación minera de túneles de los ingleses y ahí están todas las chatarras que dejaron, la contaminación que dejaron, y hoy el gobierno ha creado el Parque Nacional para poner un alto de que todos los pobladores no deben de utilizar los materiales naturales que hay ahí. Pero sí sabemos que nuestra área, entonces, ahora no hemos dado cuenta que existe 13 concesiones mineras en esa área de los 3 corregimientos, por el cual entonces estamos en una lucha de seguir adelante fortaleciendo nuestra identidad cultural, y por lo cual tenemos que protegerla, porque el gobierno muchas veces en la educación, en la aula de clases, nos prohíben hablar sobre de nuestro idioma, nuestra cultura. Solo quieren que los niños estudien la tecnología, pero para en la forma del beneficio de ellos y para utilizarlo, que en esa forma es el desarrollo con la minería, es el desarrollo con la hidroeléctrica. Y por eso entonces nosotros seguimos organizando para pedirle el apoyo a diferentes grupos solidarios de que nuestro territorio está fuera de una ley, pero nuestra organización estamos en lucha y que con la visión de que el gobierno nos reconozca un derecho de ley para entonces crear un programa de desarrollo para la comunidad, porque ahora el territorio es sin derecho de ley por el pueblo. El gobierno quiere agarrar y abarcar todo lo que es del pueblo para decirle que el desarrollo, entonces el desarrollo, ahorita mismo el gobierno está hablando de 13 concesiones mineras y tenemos experiencia, el Parque Nacional de Omar Torrijos Herrera, que es el que habló el compañero Esteban, El Parque Nacional Omar Torrijos Herrera se creó para proteger los animales, el ambiente, recursos naturales, pero hoy existe toda esa contaminación que él presentó en un momento. Dejaron todos los desechos tóxicos para las comunidades y hoy todavía también esas comunidades y el territorio está desalojando los personales. Y por eso entonces en nuestra área ya están con 13 concesiones mineras, pero estamos oponiéndonos a eso. Y por eso entonces estoy muy agradecido con Esteban y los estudiantes que nos acompañaron, que nos fueron a capacitar en Panamá. Y ahora con mi experiencia de estar acá con ustedes, pues le agradezco mucho a Colin Scott y a su equipo de trabajo y a todos ustedes que no hemos compartido en intercambio de ideas. Veo que casi todas las poblaciones que han planteado vemos la misma situación de estrategia que están utilizando en contra del pueblo originario. Muchas gracias.
Thank you so much. So we now have a discussant, Kevin Gould from Concordia University. Could I just ask Colin what time you want to finish this? We started a little late, right? Okay.
Okay, thank you very much. My name is Kevin Gould. I'm a professor at Concordia University in the Department of Geography, Planning, and Environment. And really appreciate having a chance to speak to all of you, and especially to speak after Rosa and the rest of the people on this panel. So I'm really pleased, and a chance to speak with all of you. So I want to kind of recall a little bit the comments that we've heard over the course of the conference so far, and especially last night after the main talk. There were a lot of comments about the issues of dispossession related to conservation, to some extent about colonialism. A comment about bad policies are like living with sin caught my attention, if I heard it right. The idea of people making treaties for decades before they're finished and they could still be born missing an arm or a leg. This really kind of imagery really struck me. Another person spoke about the failure to speak of the impoverishment caused by conservation, the importance of sovereignty. So. Some really strong critiques, some really strong analysis in terms of thinking about the colonial context of the kinds of policies that we're struggling to improve. Let's see. I guess I take a particular angle on this because the countries of reference for me are the United States, Canada, and Guatemala. And these are all places where there is tremendous violence against indigenous people, where truth commissions have shown that governments are guilty of genocide. So that's a kind of context for me and how I kind of come at these things. Also, I think about our disciplines. I'm talking to the academics. Our disciplines, geography, anthropology, and other disciplines. And we know the origins of these disciplines. They have origins in colonialism, right? This is where they were born. And geography helped to map the spaces of indigenous people, and anthropology helped to know the people who lived in colonized areas. So these are not innocent histories, right? So if these are the origins, we have to ask, to what extent are we reinforcing or helping to dismantle colonial relations? So that's kind of my first question. It's very broad. To what extent are we reinforcing colonial relations as we work on these policies, and to what extent are we helping to dismantle them, right? And of course, even with our best intentions. And then more specifically, when we think about the power of maps in that process of, in which geography has been a part of colonialism, we have to especially ask that question because we continue to use maps. So how does our continued work with maps sort of allow those colonial relations to continue, even though we don't, even though we hope that it wouldn't? What is the legacy from the past? How do we continue to live through these past processes and problematics? Okay, so let's sharpen this up. You're like, well, when is he gonna talk about the panel? This is about the panel. Because this panel, right, is about maps. This panel is, Mike, I'm a geographer, right? I know more about maps than video. But it relates in a certain way. They're similar in a sense of trying to produce a particular vision, a particular image or understanding of people and how they live. So I'm going to read a quote from someone who is more pessimistic than me. I'm pretty pessimistic, but this person is more pessimistic. Audre Lorde, she says, the master's tools will never dismantle the master's house, right? A lot of you have heard this quote. The master's tools will never dismantle the master's house. They may allow us temporarily to beat him at his own game, but they will never enable us to bring about genuine change. The tools, the master's tools, the maps, the these kinds of techniques, they will never let us win, maybe just for a moment. So what's the question? Are these the master's tools? First of all, how many people participate in community mapping program as a teacher, as a participant, as a mapper? How many people? How many people are involved in some way in this? I thought it would be even more, but it's a lot, right? And so I think for that reason, it's important to ask these questions because it is such an important strategy, right, of co-management, this kind of mapping things together. Like, it's good to reflect on this because it's so influential. So that was the first question. Are these the master's tools? Can they help us to get to sovereignty and to end dispossession for indigenous communities? I mean, it seemed like that was the goal. Everyone seemed like they're talking about sovereignty. They're talking about ending colonial relations. So can it do it? And what kinds of compromises and calculations are made in adopting these technologies? What kinds of compromises? What kind of calculations, right? It can't be 100% sort of useful. And since there are many of you who have worked in these areas, I think you have much more to say than me. You have much more experience. You have much more insight into the contradictions of participatory mapping or community video than I do. That doesn't mean I'm going to stop. I'm actually going to speak a little longer. But
in 2 minutes.
In 2 minutes. Okay. So, okay. Yeah, I am not self-limiting. So I want you to think about, right, what are these contradictions? What are these tensions, and how have you overcome them in participatory mapping or participatory video? And I'm just going to give a couple examples of tensions, okay, of places where this kind of technology can produce kind of good result and difficult result. But I'm hoping it just inspire you. You probably have better idea. So one simple idea is through technology. If the goal of creating sovereignty, of finishing colonial relations, is autonomy, if we depend on high-tech mapping from other places, does that create a contradiction with autonomy? OK, Okay, very simple. Using technology you don't make. Does it create a contradiction or no? It costs a lot of money. Who pays the debt? And you know, when you do a Google workshop, what cannot be discussed? Or what just generally gets framed out, right? These are kind of tensions. What gets accomplished and what can't be accomplished? So the technology, that's my first example. What about state relations? A lot of times states have the, these technologies are very connected to state power, right? Who has the best maps, right? Who has the best maps? The military, for the most part. Who has the video from the sky, you know, the drones and the surveillance video, right? Like, it comes from the state. And a lot of times, digital information will find its way back to the state. So what kind of contradictions relate to the relation with the state? And then we can also think about the knowledge that's created. Of course, the maps that we looked at today are in a kind of Cartesian space. Like, they're a kind of Western idea of what space is. So if territory is made of stories, if territory is made of culture, if territory is itself sovereignty and indigenous people, what do we lose when it's kind of reduced down to maps? And of course, here you see really innovative ways of making sort of expanding on the simple kind of Cartesian map, but there's still much, nothing, I think, compared to a kind of indigenous vision of territory. So where does that get us into trouble? One more example. This morning, someone says, the only rational strategy for the Maasai is mobility. The only rational strategy for the Maasai is mobility. But with community mapping, a lot of times it's very important to map set areas. It kind of contributes to defending a certain area. It's difficult to map a whole like kind of open space of movement, right? There's a kind of contradiction. So if autonomy is being able to move, even the best counter map might run us into trouble. Okay, this is my last statement. So the point is not that we shouldn't do it, right? You know if you should do it. You have the information. No one is innocent. But I think if you want, it might be interesting to reflect on the contradictions or the complications, not so we can, feel smart, but so we can sharpen these tools. These tools are kind of weapons. The video, the maps, make them sharp, make them strong, right? So how do they work? How are they, you know, arma de dos filos, right? So, thank you.
Thanks so much for that challenge launch to us all. So we now have about 20 minutes for questions from the floor.
If I could just maybe respond in a broad way to the challenge that we just had. Just to say one thing, in the presentation that I just gave, you'll notice that we didn't actually show any of the really good stuff, any of the good maps, any of the rich 20 years worth of stories and place-based information that we have, and there's a reason for that. You know, Kathleen and the people in the Hul’qumi’num communities are holding that powerful knowledge very close to their chests, and they use it very strategically in a very powerful way to make a difference. And I think when you see things that like bad treaty offers being rejected because the community was well informed by these maps, you know that they're powerful and successful and useful. And I think those are the reasons why communities are investing so heavily in them and actually engaging in these processes.
So there's a couple of hands over here.
I have the mic here.
Okay, gotcha.
Thank you very much.
Who gets the mic first?
I don't know if that is democratic or hijacked. But
co-management of mics.
My heart is because This particular last presentation has really awakened me because of the importance of the things that our friend and colleague have just said. I am very happy with all the presentations on mapping. Thank you very much. But like he said, and I come from the third world countries. I come from Tanzania. I was the person who spoke about mobility. And for me, the train has left the station. Any other map is a big indicator, red light, that our livelihoods are in trouble if we're not part of the mapping group. If a decision is made without us, we are in trouble. For me, a better map is a map that I am part of, not as an object, but as a subject of my own future, as a driver of my own future. The glasses that I will have to use in that map must be my glasses, not borrowed glasses. If the technology is yours and ideas are mine, I am lost, because that is not, I'm dehumanized, sorry to use those very strong terms. I am left behind, and the train has gone with the technology, the knowledge, the skills. I want to say, sorry, it's a question, but also a comment, that I think the biggest problem in the entire discussions that we have is around your understanding of and your theory of what change and development is all about. For me, that's where there is a problem. And for me, that's where I want to unpack, interrogate, and appreciate. The biggest problem is around the theory that is governing the way we think. And if we step back 1 minute to talk about my philosophy of being, my philosophy of becoming, and my philosophy of belonging, that theory is very important. If I'm not part of that, if my theory of being, of becoming, and of belonging is distanced, then I'm an empty vessel. I'm not a human being. And everything that is going to be made is not for me. And this is how I find myself not only marginalized and cut into pieces, but dehumanized at the end of the day. The other thing is the glasses. Which glasses are we using to examine this? Which technology and who owns that technology are very, very fundamental questions for me. And finally, I think, just to tell you a little story and finish, sorry for taking your time, I apologize for that. In 2009, a big drought hit Tanzania. When it hit actually not only Tanzania, but also Kenya. The Kenyans from the northern part of Kenya moved to Tanzania, where the rains were a bit better. And then, we then utilized resources that were there in northern Tanzania and together moved to the south. What blocked us from moving is a boundary which is mapped, is a map that's showing this is the end of movement. Because now we are stepping into a national park called Tarangire National Park. Inside that Tarangire National Park, there's plenty of grass, but we are not allowed because this is a national park. Human beings are not allowed, livestock are not allowed. But we wanted to go in, and we guided our own people that the only place with pasture is in Tarangire. The problem is we are not allowed to mix with wildlife. We did a study and understood that wildlife at 108 kilometers inside the park, because it is in this 180 that they find water and grass. For us, all we wanted was standing biomass, dry biomass. We will walk a different direction 2 days later to find water. Then we said, who made the map? We followed the map up to a place called Dodoma and met with the Ministry of Natural Resources and Tourism and asked him, for the Maasai from Kenya and Tanzania to utilize natural resources that are standing and which will not be eaten by anybody for only 2 months before the next rain came or comes, so that we save our livelihoods, we save our cattle. If we don't do that, our cattle will die and the nation state will not be able to get into its Millennium Development Goals and development vision. That was said, no, you cannot. I cannot allow you until we go to the Standing Committee of Parliament on Natural Resources and Tourism. We went to that one. They said, no, because it has a big implication for the tourists who come to our country. When they find cattle and wildlife all mixed together, that doesn't look good. We went to the minister, prime minister, and he said, no, it has to be decided by the president. By the time we arrived in the presidential office, 90% of the livestock were in very bad shape. A few weeks later, there was a decision that no, livestock will not be allowed to go into Tarangire because that will violate the interests of those people called tourists. 70% of the livestock died that year in 2000. And Maasai people who were once rich became poor overnight. Two weapons have been used. One, mapping, to separate us in our own land from our own natural resources. Second thing, policies were bad. Stupid policies have been used to justify our death. The following year, the president visited Arusha and went to Longido. He saw so many sad people and he wanted to know why. He was told that the drought of 2009-2010 killed 70% to 80% of their livestock herd. And as such, they're now much more poorer, they're very vulnerable, they can't afford to laugh, smile, or clap hands. The president, his heart, very good heart. This president is leaving office tomorrow. Tomorrow is election in Tanzania. We will not sleep tonight because we want to see what is going to happen. The president then gave 11 billion shillings to a special project to really give pastoralists livestock. What do you say that in English? Restocking. People in Longido, Monduli, Ngorongoro district got more livestock. They clapped their hands, they were singing, very happy. But we said, drought, given climate change, is coming again. The map is still there, the lines are still there. And this time, it will not be the pastoral livestock which will die, it will be the president's livestock which will die. I want to leave you with a question. On such a powerful, beautiful weapon called mapping, on the one hand. On the other, a dangerous tool that can dehumanize people once and for all. If the mapping cannot build a strong process of development that humanizes people, if it cannot maintain relations within groupings of people who are working together, and if it cannot produce results that takes people forward, then I think this tool is the most dangerous tool ever in the history of humankind. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your comments and your statements. That is the primary reason the Lyackson First Nation decided to take up this tool themselves. They felt that this tool was being wielded against them, and the only way that they could defend themselves was to take up the tool. And I realize that the discussor talked about the Lord's house will never be taken down by his own tools. But I don't agree with that. I think that it will indeed be taken down or taken apart or in part dismantled and reframed in a way that will include the indigenous peoples. And that is how we're taking up this tool, is to provide our governance authority over our traditional lands in a way that makes sense to us. Because the mapping tools that have been used before have not made sense to us. They have not they have no, the Eurocentric view of land ownership does not fit within our cultural landscape. Brian has done a part of his thesis on how the Coast Salish own land, because we do have a concept of land ownership. We have several of them, actually. So in our view, to exercise our governing authority, we had to create these maps, and we had to define and identify what the important cultural landscapes were to us in a way that made sense to us, and not, and it is not comfortable. It's not a comfortable fit for the local governments, for the provincial government, or for the federal government. They want to see things in little tiny, can you approve this little tiny dock or not? And we say we have to look at that dock in the context of the larger number of docks in the whole 300,000 hectares, 200 and something thousand hectares of water, because that one little tiny dock can be cumulatively combined a combined impact to us and our ability to access our foreshores and our shell fisheries. So we agree that it is a terrible and dangerous tool, and that was my complaint, was that we have to be very cautious in how we use that tool, and we have to, but we have to use it in a way that makes sense to us. Thank you.
Any comments from the rest of the panel?
Yeah, my name is Mordecai Ogada from Kenya. About the participatory video, it's obviously a very useful tool, but in Panama, as it is in Kenya, a lot of time the source of these problems is external. In this particular case, these mining companies and interests are here in Canada. Are these participatory videos being used to try and address these issues at source? Some of the injustices, or most of the injustices done in the name of conservation in Kenya, are funded with money mostly from the United States. And I'm wondering if we can explore ways of using these participatory videos to treat the source of the problems rather than just the symptoms at the point where they occur. Thank you.
I guess I would just concur. I mean, in no sense would I think that the use of video in the context that I was discussing is sort of symptomatically. I mean, these are hugely complex problems, and you're right, the root of it in this case is often Canadian companies. And, you know, a video of any nature is not going to stop a mine, but in terms of bearing witness to what's actually transpiring, it can certainly raise awareness both, I mean, the internet is international, within Canada, abroad, and sort of galvanize solidarity. I mean, I can give you specific examples of how video has been used. I mean, the videos that I was talking about made their ways up into parliamentary commissions in discussions of legislation that would potentially hold Canadian mining companies somewhat accountable for the crimes, the environmental crimes and human rights violations that they may commit abroad. That bill was killed. It was actually killed by the Liberal government, who's now in power. It was proposed by the Liberals and killed by the Liberals. This is when the Conservatives had a minority parliament. Nonetheless, I mean, what can I tell you? There were myself and several other documentarians were asked to use these images to testify. And, you know, I can't know what the effect of these images was on the parliamentarians who eventually struck the bill down. But it's a tiny, you know, drop in a large bucket. It's a tiny pebble in a pond that I would hope can be used to do exactly as you say, address the problem at its root. You know, it's a very complicated problem. The funding model for these mining companies is a Canadian problem. And, you know, that needs to be addressed in Canada fundamentally for these problems. And my hope is that the testimonies of people who are living on the ground and experiencing the implications of these bad policies in Canada would sway, amongst other things, policymakers and Canadians themselves to change their mentalities. We had this wonderful comment from the gentleman from Tanzania to have a, you know, the discourse by which I understand myself cannot tear me to pieces. And I think Canadians tend to have a particular rosy discourse of Canada as a very sort of munificent, benevolent force in the international stage. That's kind of, that was sullied with the, our last 10 years of our the fascist regime we just emerged from. But, you know, I think if Canadians could sort of begin to see the crimes that are being committed in their names, there might actually be a discursive shift within Canada by which Canadians would not just sort of an activist fringe, but Canadians as a population would demand of their policymakers the type of changes that would, you know, benefit people who are being victimized abroad by Canadian companies. So I would just say I concur with you. I mean, to what extent can video actually accomplish that? I mean, these are tiny drops in the bucket, but that's sort of my hope going in. Not at all, as you said at the end of your question, to address something symptomatically. But
Caroline?
Yes. Thank you to all the presenters. I'm Caroline Desviens from Laval University. These are, I find, very inspiring presentations. And like Kevin, I'm a geographer, so I address this, I guess, from not from a cartography, but a geography perspective. And you quoted Audre Lorde, which I think is quite appropriate. But we also have Marc Momonier, who wrote a famous book, How to Lie with Maps. And I think the issue here in relating to your comments is that, of course, you know, powers, colonial powers have lied with maps for hundreds of years. But what you're all presenting, and with the video as well, is how to speak the truth, and with an S, right, multiple truths, with maps. And that's a very important aspect of mapping as it is, you know, taken over and reinvented, I guess, by indigenous peoples. And I guess it is reinvented, I think, because what I'm, that's my reading of it, is that people are looking at the map not just as a series of locations or a line showing boundaries, but looking at the map as a narrative. And, you know, Sébastien's work definitely shows that in the work that you're doing on the West Coast. And, the map here is really a narrative, and a narrative of being and belonging, and it's bringing forward a different language, a different spatial language, and therefore a different ontology about the land and the relationship to the land. So I don't think anyone can afford to leave that behind at this point. So I think Kevin's question, thank you for challenging everyone with that, but I would have called on a geographer, Marc Momonier. Yes, we, you know, maps have lied, how to lie with maps, and he shows you in the book some of the tricks for doing that. But I think that indigenous peoples right now are showing lots of tricks, the reverse side of that, how to speak truth with maps. So I guess, I don't know, I'm sorry, that's not a question, that's more a commentary, but I'd love to hear some reactions to that. And I will.
Well, as one of the two indigenous people on this panel, I guess what I would say is that is our intent in taking up mapping. It is to tell our truth. It is to share with the world what is important to us to protect, what is important to us to use, how it is best to use those resources and those lands in a way that we are comfortable with. We weren't able to go through our full presentation here, but one of the slides showed a major project called Poets Cove, where they pretty much terraformed the land to create their resort on the waterfront. And one of the land use planning initiatives, part of the policy part of it, was to ensure that that does not happen on Lyackson's watch, on lands that we are responsible for, on lands that we can take up our governing authority over by creating a map and creating policies that support that mapping exercise, that describe our laws, that tell, that share the story of our laws and the truth of our laws. And that is one of the benefits that Canadian Aboriginal people have, is that we have taken up, and this is part of the reason I disagree with our discussor, we have taken up the tools of the master, and we have dismantled part of his house.
We have people here from Chilcotin, which is a landmark court case, and that landmark court case helped us preserve and protect Grace Islet. So it is the truth that we are putting down in how we view the land, our relationship to the land, our responsibility to the land, and our connection to the land, as well as maybe even the more esoteric components of the spiritual connection that we have to the land. So all of that overlays the map, and sometimes the map itself, that's why I said maps are limited. Maps are risky. There's a huge risk with mapping. But it's a tool, if we use it right, we can defend ourselves and our interests. I don't know if that helps.
I know there's a couple of hands. I just want to add a quick comment on the dehumanizing part of the map. This is what Brian earlier said like a long time ago, and you're completely right in that. Like the way it works, it has to remove people in order to show something else. It's been used as a colonial power, a military power, because then there's no more people. Therefore, you can do whatever you want with a map because it's just borders and there's nothing else. I don't think we can ask the map to do everything. It does very well a few things. It does very well synthesizing our relationship to place and seeing things that we will never see. And it does it very well. So it has this power to do that. But it does not deal well with human issues and human representation. So my personal sense is that we need to combine it with something else if we want to convey more things about our personal relationship with places. And I think video does it so well. I mean, video, you can convey a lot of things that when someone is super emotional in front of video, you get that right away. When you turn that into a SAMO, it does, like, it's completely gone. You just like you removed it. So my sense is like if the idea, and I think this is one idea that is really important, is to, if you want to bring the human back into the map, you need to find something else than just the map. And that's the way I think we should work.
Yeah, hi, Charles Menzies. I actually want to stand with the discussant statements. And I think there's something important about that idea. I'm just going to stand outside of that speaker. There's something important with understanding the deployment of power. And we might be confusing or misunderstanding the map and fetishizing it in a sense as something other than what it is. It's simply a tool. But map deployed in particular power arrangements actually do things. They do in fact displace people. Maps and data, traditional use studies in which data is collected, codified, and lodged with government agencies and officials actually does enter into a power game that is deployed against people. It's not to say I haven't been engaged in making maps. I make maps all the time. I grew up on a commercial fishing enterprise where we notated maps. Maps are inscribed. So to suggest in one sense that there is both from speaking as an indigenous person, that there's the indigenous narrative of a map, and then to stand over here with my non-indigenous side and say, well, no, maps are absent of any narrative and they're a deployment of power upon people. Well, they're neither in both. And I think the important thing here is actually the way in which a tool is appropriated and used and deployed. It's not the thing itself that's the problem or the solution. And there, I also think that part of what's going on is internally within our indigenous communities, there is a growing and emerging comprador bourgeoisie that have actually quite happy with deploying and taking on the instruments of power, the tools of suppression, and they use those just as effectively in the engagement as the colonial powers do. And too often we're afraid to talk about those issues, though I did hear it mentioned once or twice in some of the discussions, but there is a problem with that it has to be confronted, but that is an internal struggle that's hard to actually move beyond the indigenous community, because it often gets presented by the likes of Bill Vander Zam or people might not know, or Thom Flanagan, another backroom person. So I think we need to focus on the deployment of power and how particular tools are used. So to suggest that my uncle isn't smoking fish the correct way when he uses a propane torch to light the fire that's based in a pink ceramic bathtub in the smokehouse is to misunderstand the difference between tool and process. And so what I would ask us to think about is the particular process and deployment of power, not the tool itself, because I am quite happy appropriating all the tools that are available to me, but it has to come under the authority and jurisdiction of a sovereign nation, not as an implementation upon our backs or upon ourselves. Thank you.
One of the things that I just wanted to observe in this discussion is the actual practice of the inscribing on the map and how important that is, and how strategic we are and thoughtful we are about deciding whether we're going to put a point at a particular place or we're going to represent that by circling an area, and all of those kinds of representations have their inadequacies. The point doesn't give it any kind of spatial extent if you're examining it at a certain scale, and the area, defining it with a polygon creates a boundary that may not really be there. And cumulatively, these things can be taken to draw boundaries and borders. I was very interested in looking at the maps that were shown this morning of the James Bay Cree, of the hunting territories, of the families that were all very neatly contiguous, sort of one beside the other with no kind of fuzzy boundaries in the middle, on the same maps that we were seeing in the southern part of Quebec. And, all the maps that we have but chose not to show are far more messy. They don't have these kinds of unambiguities. But then they get employed in a way that meet the expectations of the people who are consuming the maps, the National Energy Board or the Environmental Assessment Panel or the Land Claims Commission or the courts will all have their own sets of expectations of what the maps ought to look like and where the white spaces can't be and how they ought to be filled. And so I think there's a lot to the kind of strategic representations that indigenous communities are engaging in and as they're crafting these tools. And I think there's a lot of dangers in them. I know certainly, one thing that comes to mind is are the kind of overlaps and the easy way you can piss your neighbors off by making the wrong kind of map or representing things on the map in the wrong way, and the very divisive problems that can come out of those maybe more careless way of putting forward maps. And I think these are cautions that Indigenous communities are very aware of and are using quite carefully.
If I could just sort of very briefly bring some of these conversations together and begin by actually concurring with Charles's point and even take it a step further and sort of offer that these questions of the attention to the circulation of power and the potential circulation of power with these technologies is a question that has to be posed at every step of the way, because every time a new level of technology or technological intervention is added, technology understood broadly, new potentials for abuse emerge. And so it's actually Davikin who would be more suitable to speak to this, but Davikin, Sednik Gisbert, historian over here, has been working with the community in Urracá to create an atlas, a really wonderful document in the region. And I was sort of fortunate enough to be there for the presentation of the first draft of this atlas and to see the sensitivity within the community of who can access this document. It's not being taken lightly. Now, there's been also some discussion about how can we wed video and the mapping. So how can we use the video technology to perhaps record testimonials of elders or of people in the community that can then be possibly combined with the atlas to have the narrative of people in their own words, the stories of people in their own words archived as a component that adds on to the map or incorporated into the map. These are complicated questions technologically. How would you access it? But I would say that at every level of the problematic you encounter, we should sort of heed Charles's caution. So if we think, how are these videos archived? We would think, well, who can access them? And what are the implications of accessing these narratives? And how can these narratives be abused? How can these narratives be then used for nefarious purposes? And so I think, and a lot of these questions don't have concrete answers. They may have unpredictable, unforeseen consequences of, of opening up narratives and stories for the world to view, putting something online. It can never be taken down. And I just think that these are, you know, it was humbling to see the caution with which the people of Urracá, Saturnino can attest to this, Celestino as well, the caution with which this is a powerful, powerful tool. We can show this to people, but we're not distributing this in the same way that we're distributing the handout for the CICADA conference. There's too much power, too much room for abuse, not only in the fact that they're being subjected to threats by land speculators now in Urracá. But, you know, if we want to talk about adding video to that, all of us privy to that conversation would then need to sort of heed this caution that Charles offers and brainstorm together what are the ways in which this could go way off the rails. Because if, as our previous questioner says, the train has left the station, on the one hand, it's very nice to think about using video to be able to use the test of the discourses of one person in the space, expressing their own vision for development and their own ontology, their own way of being in their words. But what are the potential ways in which that particular expression, if released, if disseminated too publicly, and there's not a whole lot of middle ground when you put something online, mm-hmm. what are the potential implications for backfire? And I don't offer any concrete solutions to that, but I just sort of, you know, I applaud this type of reflection, and I kind of heed this as well in my own, you know, baby steps that I take into this, the extreme caution that I think is important to apply to the use of these technologies. Not to avoid it, but just to be cognizant that there's serious power in the abuse of these technologies, which also have serious power for galvanizing communities and for, dare I say, emancipating in a certain level people's capacity to speak to themselves and amongst themselves about their visions and their stories and their narratives and their histories and all this really important, rich stuff. So I'll just sort of leave that at that.
We have time for one more question. I believe it was down the front. Okay.
Un comentario. A nuestro juicio, consideramos que todas las herramientas es útil. En el escenario que nos encontramos, a sabiendas de que las leyes y los límites de fronteras fueron creados después del hombre, no antes del hombre. Es posible hoy estudiarla, analizarla y ver si la transformamos. Pero para eso es requerible encontrar las armas del enemigo o las herramientas que utiliza el enemigo. Porque es fácil, pienso yo, que después que sepamos entender a manipular un AK-47 que utiliza el enemigo, apenas logremos empoderarla, podemos entonces controlar un problema a través de las mismas herramientas. Y pienso que en este escenario, por lo que está pasando, lo que ha pasado y está pasando, es menester esas herramientas, parte por parte, que son las que los enemigos han utilizado, poniendo en práctica una herencia o una herencia colonial que ha venido hace muchos años, donde se está aplicando una política de transformación y de apoderamiento. Digo transformación porque yo creo las leyes y tengo que darte un seminario y hacerte entender que usted tiene que cumplir esto porque esto es ley, sin opinión ninguna al respecto. Y el apoderamiento es el poder de un gobernante que las aplica. Entonces, entendiendo que las normas también tiene pros y contras, y entendiendo que las normas las hace el ser humano para el bien o para el mal, a como se habla de la arma de doble filo, y quiero poner como el ejemplo la Biblia. La Biblia en su parte ofrece la vida eterna para el que camina bien, pero también ofrece la muerte para el que camina mal. Entonces nosotros tenemos que identificar esto valiéndonos de las herramientas que hay. Hablando de mapas, hablando de video, para nosotros con los pueblos, es nueva experiencia conocer la parte tecnológica que nos ayuda a nosotros impulsar nuestras aspiraciones a la vez nuestras inquietudes. Para mí, es posible que esto ayude bastante a nosotros a avanzar en los conflictos que hay, sociales, ambientales, territoriales. Porque ya es hora de que nos pongamos a analizar la forma en que el poder y el sistema nos tiene asfixiado y las normas adversas a nuestro derecho, y tomar esas herramientas y elaborar algo parecido, pero para establecer nuestros intereses, el derecho de los territorios y los problemas sociales. Es hora de asentarnos a analizar de qué forma nos sirven las herramientas. Porque digo que tenemos fe de que esto va a ocurrir y necesitamos esas herramientas, porque ya están naciendo muchos analíticos, muchos curiosos que están analizando lo que pasó ayer y cómo estamos y qué podemos hacer mañana. Es como alguien, que algún curioso que aparezca analíticamente diga, bueno, esa oración que dice Ave María, Madre de Dios, ruega por nosotros los pecadores, la quisiera cambiar de otra forma y que diga Ave María, Madre de Dios, ruega por nosotros para que no seamos pecadores. Porque si yo digo ruega por nosotros los pecadores, entonces estoy declarándome lo que estoy haciendo y quién soy yo. Entonces, como nosotros no entramos en ese contexto, no somos los destructores, no somos los saqueadores, no somos los que nos apoderamos de los bienes ajenos, no podemos orar de esa manera. Entonces hay que hacer normas comunitarias con el pensamiento y criterio propio nuestro de los derechos y valores que consideramos que nos compete, ¿verdad? Y para llegar a ese extremo del apoderamiento, del poder y la transformación, es que de aquí en adelante nosotros tenemos que entender que la mejor herramienta para cambiar un Estado y para cambiar esas normas que asfixian los derechos sociales es la concienciación, empezando del pensamiento de uno mismo, sus hijos, su familia, sus amistades, y de esa manera construir una nueva generación que en el mañana dirija el país con un modelo diferente. Y por eso yo sí creo que hay que empezar desde lo pequeño, tomando en cuenta que es importante estas herramientas que estamos tratando. Muchas gracias.
Bueno, para hacer un pequeño comentario sobre de lo que estábamos hablando, para nosotros el distrito de Urracá es muy importante haber tenido la oportunidad de esta tecnología, ya que no habíamos tenido una experiencia porque vivimos en un lugar muy distante, como lo empecé diciendo, pero ahora hemos comentado muchas cosas, por ejemplo, nuestra cultura. Nuestra cultura es algo que anteriormente se traspasaba de los abuelos a los nietos y así seguía llevando las esculturas, pero en aquel tiempo no había una educación, una escuela. Hoy día los estudiantes van a estudiar y de repente tienen que ir de un lugar a otro muy lejano y desde ahí entonces van perdiendo la cultura. Y entonces ahora he visto en gran parte de la población ya se está perdiendo la cultura. Entonces, por eso de nuestra parte, no hemos sentido muy orgullosos de haber tenido esa experiencia, porque en esa forma podemos conocer nuestro territorio con el mapeo. Con este conocimiento también podemos hacer un documento para nuestras generaciones hacia el futuro, que lo que han perdido en aquel tiempo hoy no se pueden recuperar, porque muchos abuelos, mucha sabiduría que se fueron con ellos y hoy día lo quieren rescatar y no se pueden rescatar. Y gracias a la tecnología de hoy, pues podemos guardar nuestros documentos, nuestra cultura, nuestra tradición, que es algo valioso, es algo autónomo, que nunca se debe de perder en diferentes diferentes razas de cultura de las personas se debe de guardar. En esa forma podemos utilizar también la tecnología, aunque no lo hicimos, es ajeno. Pero a base de la educación, entonces podemos utilizarlo en diferentes formas y así dar una mejor enseñanza a la población y de ir despertando cuál es la realidad. Que lo que se vivía en 50 años hacia atrás no se está viviendo hoy. Lo que se vivía en 50 años hacia atrás, muchas generaciones con mucha sabiduría, muchas riquezas que se fueron y que hoy no se podrán rescatar jamás. Muchas gracias.
So thanks everyone, both on the panel and in the audience, for what I think was a really great discussion, even a debate. We need more of this, that's what we're here for. So we're going to have a break of about half an hour or so before dinner at 6 o'clock. Thanks.